Dr. Matthew Moore. He received a PhD in political science from the Johns Hopkins University. He is a professor at Cal Poly who primarily teaches about political theory and issues in public law. He will be presenting his talk, The Coming Insurrection and the Anattā Doctrine, Would We Be Better Off Without the Self? Thank you.
Hello, thanks. I've already been introduced, so I won't do it again. But first, I wanted to thank the organizers of the forum for putting this event together and having me here, and also all of you for coming and staying to hear this talk. Tonight's talk is based on my current research. My area of specialty is political philosophy, and I'm currently working on political philosophy from the Western tradition and its connections with Buddhism. So I'm working on a series of articles trying to figure out where are there overlaps, where are there differences, and are those differences instructive? That connects to the forum's theme of what it means to be human, because one of the central contentions of Buddhism is that we don't have selves, and that that's a good thing, that we all mistakenly believe that we either are or have selves, and that if we could get past that mistake, we would be better off and happier. That, however, takes a little bit of explaining. So let me get right to it. I want to start out with what I'm hoping is going to be a non-controversial claim. I think that all of you believe that you either are or have selves. Seem plausible so far? Okay, good. What does that mean? I think self is one of those words, you say it and it seems so plausible, so commonsensical, and say, well, what do you actually mean by that? Do I have a self? Am I a self? And I want to propose to you that when we talk about selves, we're actually talking about three different things. The first is identity. Whatever the self is, whatever it turns out to be, it's what makes you you, right? So when we think about, I talk about myself, my core essence, right? It's that thing that makes me the individual that I am. It can't be shared with anyone else. No one can take it away from you. And other people have really only a very limited ability to affect it. Right, so if someone else can really change yourself, well, it's not really what we meant by a self, right? The self is in some sense inviolate. Second, we mean that the self has continuity. The self that you have today is the same self you had when you were in grade school. It's the same one you'll have when you're elderly, right? It's the thing that stays the same. You're not the same height anymore. You're not the same weight as you were when you were a child. You may look very different. No doubt you've gotten big and buff at the Cal Poly gym, right? There are all kinds of different ways in which you've changed. Your eye color may have changed. When I was a kid, my eyes were much lighter. They darkened as I got older. My hair is different. You know, all kinds of things are different. But myself, if there is such a thing, must be the same. So there has to be some kind of crucial continuity for whatever it is that we think might be the self to be a self. And finally, the self has kind of a funny relationship to causality, and I already mentioned it a little bit. So two things have to be true. On the one hand, if you have a self, your self has to be the cause of much of your own internal experience, and it has to be the cause of much of your behavior. Now, why is that true? Well, if you think about it, if the self isn't the cause of your experience and it isn't the cause of your behavior, what is it? It's sort of like the ether, right? So as you know, I should leave this to the expert, but I'm going to go for it anyway, right? Energy appears to move in waves. And so scientists at a certain point said, well, okay, but what about outer space? What is there? What's the medium through which energy travels in space? And so they posited the notion of the ether. There must be kind of an invisible something there that is the medium through which those waves travel. And the ether kind of fell out of fashion, right? No one ever disproved the ether. It just turned out not to be useful anymore. In a way, the self would be like that unless we thought that it had some kind of causal effect that made you you, right? So it has some kind of cause on your experiences and your behavior. But, and this is the piece that I mentioned before, the self also has to, in some way, be resistant to external causes. If I could influence yourself in such a way that it was no longer what it used to be, then we violated the continuity requirement, right? You're no longer the same self. If I could destroy yourself without destroying your body, or your brain, right? If I could in some way undermine yourself, well, that doesn't seem to live up to the continuity requirement again. If I could swap yourself with someone else's self, it doesn't seem to fulfill the identity requirement. Right? So when we talk about having a self, we mean something that makes us us, that can't be shared or taken away, something that's continuous during our lifetime, and something that has this kind of funny causal quality. It is a cause, but not an effect. And we'll come back to that. You'll see that it turns out to be an important part of the Buddha's criticism. So putting all of that together, I think that each of you believe that you are a self, that there is some personal essence or quality or something that makes you you, that remains more or less the same throughout your lifetime, and that's the main cause of your internal experiences and actions. Now, of course, I'm going to argue that you're wrong. Right? So the point of my talk tonight is to suggest to you that you don't have a self, and that it's a good thing. Now, you probably already know the basic doctrine of Buddhism, right? Almost everyone knows this, the Four Noble Truths. So the first is that life is suffering. And this is one of those places where professors get grumbly, right? So the word in Pali, right, that, which is the language in which the Buddha taught, is dukkha, which means unsatisfactory or incapable of satisfying, incapable of being kind of fully complete. And it does have the day-to-day meaning of suffering, right? So if you're suffering, dukkha would be the right word. But it has this broader sense of being kind of unsatisfactory. It's not quite the right. It's never quite right. Your life is never quite right. So when the Buddha says life is suffering, he doesn't mean that it's constant, unrelenting misery. What he means instead is that there's always something kind of niggling at you. When you're actually miserable, it doesn't take much convincing to get you to believe that life is suffering. When you're happy, of course, the Buddha says, there's always that little thought in the back of your mind, like, man, I'm having such a good time, but I do have to get up tomorrow, right? I really enjoyed those first 7 ice cream cones, but I don't know how this 8th one's going to go down. Right? There's always that kind of moment where you think, even in a moment of pleasure, maybe I know that things are eventually not going to work out. And, of course, I hesitate to tell you this, but in fact, one of the kind of cruel realities of being a professor is that we're required to reveal to you terrible truths that you haven't yet learned. And one of them is that you're all going to die. Not hopefully right now, but eventually. And, of course, it's always in the back of your mind that life is not really going to work out exactly the way it would be nice if it did. The second noble truth, and this was what the Buddha taught, by the way, in his first sermon, right? He achieves enlightenment. He says, wow, you know, I really got it. And he initially decides not to teach. He decides he's just going to go off and live quietly and happily alone. And one of the gods comes and says to him, you got to go teach. The god says, there are some people who have just a little dust in their eyes, some people who are ready to hear the truth, but they don't quite know it yet. You could show them. And it would be relatively easy. Please, for the sake of humanity, go and teach them. And so he does. He goes and finds his friends with whom he'd been meditating. And they reject him because they think that he's gone soft because he's eating too much. So they think he's no longer an ascetic. But he eventually convinces them to listen to him. And this is what he teaches them. This is the core truths of Buddhism. So the second truth is that suffering is caused by craving. And the notion here is, it's not kind of simple desire, like I need food, I need water, I need to go to sleep. That's not the kind of thing the Buddha has in mind. What the Buddha has in mind is sort of obsessive craving. Right? It's that moment when you think, I sort of must have this, and I'm kind of willing to do anything to get it. And the Buddha says, it turns out you're like that much more often than you think you are. Right? That we're so say, oh, you know, I really have to have this, and I'm willing to tell a white lie to get it. I really have to have this, and I'm willing to be nasty to someone to get it. I really need to get this, and I'm going to stay up all night, even though it's going to make me miserable tomorrow. It's those moments when you make choices that cause suffering to yourself and to other people, right? Actually, it goes back to the first noble truth. So suffering is caused by craving. He says, you could stop suffering if only you could stop craving. And now, again, he doesn't mean stopping experiencing the ordinary desires of life. He doesn't mean stopping eating, right, or stopping sleeping or something like that. Instead, what he means is, you could learn to see the difference between eating enough and overeating, between eating because you're hungry and need nutrition and eating because you just got an argument with someone and eating makes you feel better. This, in fact, is my personal vice. Every argument with my wife is, you know, 1,000 calories of making myself feel better later. The Buddha says you could learn to get past the suffering. And he says, The way you learn that, the way you kind of train yourself, is what he calls the Noble Eightfold Path. Now, I have this friend named Todd, and Todd, at this point of the discussion, always says, right, so if the first three steps are three and the fourth step is eight, then it's really the 11 noble truths, not the four noble truths. He gets very upset about this. I don't follow in his footsteps. You could learn if only you would follow the Noble Eightfold Path, which is kind of a set of rules for how to live that are really just intended to help you get past craving. I don't want to go into it in much depth, but the eight steps are right view, right intention, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Each one of those has volumes written to explain it. For our purposes, it's not really that important. But just to point out, he kind of teaches this path. Here's how you can do it. Now, the Buddha also argued that there are three characteristic mistakes that contribute to our suffering. And those three characteristic mistakes are greed, delusion, and lust or desire. Right? So we, lust, greed, and lust. Greed, hatred, and delusion. So wanting something, diswanting something, and then being confused about what the truth is. And the Buddha taught that the most fundamental delusion, the one that causes us the most trouble, is the belief that we're selves. And to try to counter this, in his second sermon, so the second public presentation after he achieved enlightenment, he taught what's called the Anattā Doctrine. Now, Anattā literally means no self, right? There is no self. For those of you who know a little bit of Sanskrit, right, the Sanskrit word for soul is Atman in Pali, which is related to Sanskrit, kind of like the way Italian is related to Latin. The word is Atta. So Anatta means no soul or no self. The Buddha taught the Anatta doctrine. The Buddha was a great teacher. He wasn't necessarily a great stylist. And so I'm not going to go through the Anatta doctrine exactly the way he taught it, because it would make this talk unnecessarily long and confusing, which I'm usually able to do all by myself. So I don't necessarily need the help. So I'm going to turn the Buddha's discussion of the Anatta doctrine into a fairly straightforward argument. He says, and this will sound familiar since we've already talked about it, he says the self would have to be a cause but not an effect. So he says to the monks, look, if there really were a self, and the self, for example, arose out of your emotions, wouldn't it be true that the self could exercise control over the emotions, that it could say, okay, I want to feel like this? And the monks say, yeah, that seems to make sense, right? That we think of the self as being the source of our experience, right? The thing that causes our experience. And he says, okay, great. Can you make yourself feel a particular way just by desiring it? And the monks say, no, I can't. He says, great, okay. How about stuff? How about matter? Can you volitionally control matter? The monks say, no, I can't do that either. It's all right, well, how about thoughts? Can you do that? Well, sort of, right? But if any of you have ever tried Buddhist meditation, you'll know that it's very simple. You simply close your eyes, you concentrate on your breath, you watch the thoughts as they arise, and then 30 minutes later, you wake up, you discover you've been thinking about something entirely different, and you wonder how that happened, right? And so, of course, it's quite difficult to volitionally control your thoughts, even though it seems as if it should be quite simple. And so he goes through, the Buddha breaks all objects of experience into five categories. He goes through each one, and he says, if there really were a self, a thing that was sort of in control of your experience, shouldn't you be able to exercise control over some one of these? And the monks admit that they can't exercise control over any of them. And he says, we don't seem to have a self that is the right kind of cause. Now he goes further to say, it also appears that the self is frequently an effect. Now remember, I mentioned earlier, the reason we want the self not to be an effect is for fear that it could be so changed that it wouldn't be the same thing, right? That you would become, in fact, someone else. And so if the self can be affected, can be influenced by external factors, that seems to suggest that what we think of as a self may not really be one. All right, so second piece of the argument. He says, nothing in our experience seems to be a cause but not an effect. There just doesn't seem to be anything. And this is where it gets a little bit more fun. You might be saying to yourself, yeah, but I'm a thing that's a cause but not an effect. right? I'm the same me that I was in third grade. And so haven't I been a cause in all the various ways in which I've interacted with the world, but I'm not an effect because I'm the same? But the Buddha says, come on, be honest with yourself. Are you really the same person you were in third grade? He says, if you really examine your experience, you'll know that the answer is no. In fact, you're probably not even the same person that you were before you had dinner, because then you were hungry and slightly cranky, whereas now you're content. And he says, you can see not just the external world, which is obviously controlled by the laws of cause and effect, but if you close your eyes and pay attention to the internal world, you'll see that that's also dominated by cause and effect. And if you get good at it, that's actually the point of meditation, you can watch it rise and fall, right? You can watch the causes come and go. You can watch the effects as they arise. So the Buddha says, you too are not the same self as you were. You're not even a good counterexample. Nothing appears to be a cause without being an effect. This leads to the conclusion, therefore, there doesn't appear to be anything in our experience that could be a self. Nothing appears to have the right qualities of continuity, identity, and this particular relationship to causality. There doesn't seem to be anything that could be a self. And the Buddha takes a little bit of a leap here, although one that he thinks is quite justified, and says, if there's nothing that could be a self, we're justified in concluding that there is no self, that your sense of self is an illusion. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about why it's an illusion and why you have one, even though it doesn't exist. The Buddha goes on to argue that this sense of self is the source of all of our problems. And it causes three kinds of problems, these sort of basic issues in the world. One is that it causes problems with non-human nature. And maybe you've heard of this, right? So it turns out that human beings are willing to use the existing natural resources that we have on the Earth in ways that, at least in some cases, appear to not be sustainable, right? So whether you think that's a good thing or a bad thing, sort of in terms of economics or morality, the Buddha actually doesn't really care. What he really wants to talk to you about is the fact that it's self-defeating, right? That it's an activity that can't be sustained. So if you engage in a certain kind of activity to pursue the interests of your fictional self, but that activity could not be sustained in the long run, you're doing something ultimately that he thinks is quite foolish. It will lead to your further suffering. And remember, again, the goal of Buddhism is to escape the suffering. It's to get beyond it. So the first is our problem with non-human nature. We have an instrumental and exploitive relationship with non-human nature. Don't even get them started about animals. It causes us problems with other people. In essence, it's the same underlying problem, right? We're willing to treat other people as means to our ends. We're willing to treat other people as something that exists to give us what we want. We're willing to lie, we're willing to cheat, we're willing to steal. As I see some members of my class here in ancient and medieval political thought, And last week we were talking a little bit about the Ten Commandments, which we'll be reading later in the quarter. And I raised this point that seems to me perfectly obvious, and I'm sure you've thought of too, which is, have you noticed that in the Ten Commandments, they didn't outlaw anything that people don't do? Right? There's no rule, apparently, against jumping off cliffs, because it turns out not to be that exciting. The Ten Commandments ban things that people are tempted to do. Right, things that that for one reason or another, many, many people have a desire to do or a temptation to do. And the Buddha says, that's what we're talking about when we're talking about the self. The self is that part of you that says, I really want this and I'm gonna take it. I really want to eat this food that is someone else's. I really wanna steal this thing that belongs to someone else. I really wanna have sex with someone else's partner. Right, all these kinds of things that we're tempted to do that we do at other people's expense. The Buddha says that's the way in which the self causes you problems with other people. Now finally, the self causes problems with yourself. Don't worry, I know it sounds kind of circular, but we'll get back to it, it'll make sense. Think about it this way. Perhaps you remember some gift-giving holiday, depending on your tradition, right? Christmas, Hanukkah, maybe your birthday, whatever it is, that some time when you've expected a gift, and you wanted like a particular gift. For example, my son is obsessed with trains, right? And if he's not actually quite old enough to have a desire for particular gifts yet, but when he is, it's going to be trains. And you know that experience of wanting a particular thing? And you come down, and on the table for your birthday or under the Christmas tree or wherever your gift is, you see the box, and it's just not big enough. I mean, there's just no way that thing you want is in that box. But while you're unwrapping the wrapping paper, you kind of think maybe it is, right? That like somehow maybe they stuffed it into that really small box, like that enormous train set somehow got folded, right? Or it's like a symbolic part, right? It's just the roundhouse and the tracks in the garage or something like that. And the Buddha says that's the way in which our sense of self causes problems for us, that we're constantly thinking, oh, I'm going to get this great thing that I know I'm not really going to get. Oh, you know, the people I love are always going to be around me and supporting me, except I know that they're not always going to be there, right? My job will never be downsized except when it is. I'll be happy at all times except when I'm not. And he says, the Buddha distinguishes between pain and suffering. So look, pain is inevitable. People are going to do crappy things to you, right? It's going to happen. Bees are going to sting you. Dogs are going to bite you. The whole Sound of Music, a panoply of bad things, they're all going to happen, right? You can't avoid pain. But suffering is what you add on top of that from your own mind. So someone insults you, it hurts your feelings, and then you spend the rest of the day thinking, well, why me? Why not someone else? Why did they insult me? Oh, the thing they said was totally insane. That doesn't even make any sense, right? And why are they mad at me anyways at that time that I took their bubble gum, right? I mean, you go through this kind of crazy internal process by which you torture yourself all over again. The pain may be inflicted by the external world. The suffering is all you. It's something that you do to yourself. Because you think you're a self, because you think you have a permanent essence to defend, whose honor must be defended. My favorite expression here is, you can't do that to me. Right? So like, oh, yeah, like there's a me, right? There's a self that has to be defended against the world that's somehow substantial. And the Buddha says, you actually could learn not to do this. And that's part of what he's going to try to teach you. Buddhism, just to speak about this piece for a second, because this will connect up to the political part that is coming in a little bit. Buddhism advocates a version of the golden rule, right? So as you probably know, sort of all the great Axial Age religions articulate some version of the golden rule. Buddhism does too. And it says, if you want to treat others and kind of ultimately yourself the right way, you've got to act the right way. You've got to establish the principle that you want to follow both in your old life and your own life and in others. Now, what I want to say about this. Connected to this sense of self are these three basic mistakes. These are three delusions. They're called the three poisons, the three bitter roots. There's a whole series of names for them in Buddhism. One is the belief that the things that give us happiness will be permanent. So as I mentioned, right, your loved ones will always be around, your job will always be available, and so on. The second is the belief that the self is permanent, right, that we'll live forever. And okay, so you know that's not true. But the Buddha argues that the sense of self is often connected to the notion of a soul. So a soul that will live on after your body dies. It may live on and go to heaven. It may live on and be reincarnated in future existences, depending on your religious background. But the Buddha says, according to him, yeah, there isn't one of those, right? That's sort of the point that he's getting at. And the Buddha argues that the reason reincarnation happens is precisely because you think you're so fascinating that you want to see what happens next, right? Reincarnation is being unwilling to let go of the pursuit of happiness and pleasure. It's holding on to it, so that you're willing to go through one more life and see what happens in that one. But of course, if you've made good choices in this life, maybe that will be a pleasant life. But if you've made bad choices in this life, it may not work out so well for you. So you're basically letting yourself in to another round of suffering. Finally, the Buddha says, we believe falsely that the world is set up such that we're always going to get pleasure from it. That if kind of, and doesn't everyone actually think this, right? That if you just kind of organize things right, your life would never be sucky, right? That if you got up at the right time, you set your alarm, you got enough sleep, you ate a good breakfast, you did your homework on time, right? If you sort of do everything right, that it could all be at least tranquil and maybe even pleasant. And the Buddha says, but again, you know from your own experience that that's not true, right? You know that life is always going to have ups and downs. There are always going to be moments of displeasure. And so you're clinging to the sense of self. You're always trying to come back and fix those problems. You're trying to say, okay, it's myself that's going to enjoy pleasure in the future. It's myself that's going to have an eternal life. It's myself that's always going to have the things around me that I want. And the Buddha says, but you know, if you're honest with yourself, that it's not so. From the Buddha's perspective, because here's the problem. So the Buddha wants you to give up the notion of the self. What are you supposed to do without it? And the Buddha says, you're still going to have all your basic experiences, right? You're still going to be hungry. You're still going to be thirsty. You're still going to be tired. You're still going to have thoughts and emotions. You're still going to have memories, right? You're still going to be a human animal. What you're not going to have is the belief that somehow all of that is unified by a self. And an example, actually, I was talking about this earlier today, an example that that came up to try to talk about that is the difference between harmony and the constituent notes that make it up. So if you think about it, right, let's say three, four different notes, right, that come together and make a harmonious sound. The harmony doesn't exist in any one of the notes. So you take one note, it's no harmony, right? If you had a harmonious sound, you say, okay, well, let's subtract out the constituent notes and figure out where the harmony is. It's a fool's errand. There isn't anything there. Harmony isn't itself an extra essence somehow laid on top of the constituent sounds. Harmony simply is what happens when you get those sounds together. Same thing with the self. There is no thing that is a self. The sense of self is simply the experience that a human animal has when it brings together bodily sensations, memories, cognition, and the capacity for reflection, right? That self is what philosophers call an emergent phenomenon, right? It's not its own separate thing. It's merely something that appears to exist as the other things add together. From the Buddhist perspective, human experience is always of an instantaneous present. All right, so how many of you saw Kung Fu Panda? Yeah, okay, yeah. Not bad, right? So there's that little joke, right, that the past is history, tomorrow is a mystery, but the only thing we have is today. That's why we call it the present. Right, today's a gift, that's why we call it a present. And the Buddha says, all you ever really experience is now. It's just that now keeps happening, right? So there's now, and then there's now, and then there's now, and then there's now, and then there's now. And at each moment, it's just the experience that you have, just the input, and both the mental input and the physical input. It's just what's happening now. And if you could live in that experience, rather than laying on top of it the narrative of continuity, of laying on top of it the narrative of unity, according to the Buddha, you would be happier. Now, when I was putting together these notes, I usually try to anticipate objections and questions, and so one that occurred to me is, and you see where this goes, if there's no self, who made the mistake of thinking there was a self? Does that make sense? Right, so in other words, there had to be something, it seems, that had the capacity to develop a self-conception, that had a sense of interests and needs, that had a sense of being able to project itself through time, that came up with this mistaken notion of the self. And so doesn't that sort of prove that even though the Buddha can't find the self, and even though we may not be able to find the self, that there's one there somewhere? There's sort of like a hidden proto-self back there somewhere. And according to the Buddha, the answer is no. And to understand why, you need to think about squirrels. Now think about squirrels for a second. Squirrels have bodies. Squirrels have roughly what we would call mind, right? So squirrels have memory, not great memories, I don't think, but I remember reading a study once that squirrels forget where they bury half the nuts they bury. And I thought, it seems likely to me that squirrels forget where they bury all of the nuts they bury, right? And they're just lucky sometimes. They find a nut. That's just my guess, right? I don't study squirrels. Squirrels have bodies. They have memories. They have sensory experience. And they have some rudimentary capacity for conceiving of themselves. For example, squirrels can learn from experience, right, squirrels appear to make at least something like a plan. I remember reading once, I have no idea if this is true, and no offense to the dog owners in the house, that if you take a dog, put it on a leash, and you wrap the leash around a pole, and then you put some food just outside of the dog's reach, that the dog will strain against the leash trying to reach the food until it passes out. But that if you do the same thing with a squirrel, after a few minutes, the squirrel will run around the pole, loosen the leash, and eat the food. Right? So squirrels have some capacity for planning. They have roughly what we mean by mind. And yet, my suspicion is you don't think squirrels have selves. Right? Squirrels don't appear to have that sense of kind of constant internal narrative that we do. And so the Buddha says, And let me say, by the way, if you think squirrels might have selves, you might think about microorganisms of some kind, bacteria, viruses, amoebas, have bodies, they have some very rudimentary capacity to react to their environment, to gather information, in some cases to store it and to act on it later. Right, so in some cases, they have something very rudimentary, rudimentarily resembling mind. Not much, but do viruses have selves? I don't think so. Right? I don't think any of us, when we talk about what we mean by a self, think that a virus has a self. And the Buddha says, look, really, squirrels are just more complicated people. Excuse me, people are just more complicated squirrels. Excuse me. People are just more complicated squirrels. You're really not fundamentally different from a squirrel. In fact, other than the lack of an attractive bushy tail, the thing that really distinguishes you from a squirrel is that you believe you have a self, right? Is this overlay that the squirrel manages to get away with not having. So the Buddha says there doesn't have to be a kind of underlying proto-self to make the mistake of having a self. All you really need is body and mind. Squirrels have it, they manage to avoid making the mistake. We almost certainly due to evolutionary history made the mistake. And so the question is, how are we gonna get past it? By the way, if it seems implausible to you that human beings could make such a fundamental mistake, right? And there is, we believe, right, so that evolution is adaptive, right? So there's a range of random mutations that happen in the genome. Some of them turn out to be useful for survival. Some of them turn out not to be. Some of them hang on anyway because they're sort of irrelevant. They're in their little evolutionary eddy. But we think that the traits that persevere generally have some utility. And so how could it be true that we have gotten this trait, this propensity to believe in a self, that's false? And is it and especially something that's as damaging as the Buddha seems to imply that it is? And this is not the Buddha's argument. This is just me being difficult. But I want to suggest to you that you actually already believe that human beings make those kinds of fundamental mistakes all the time. And let me give you a quick example. I'm going to make another bold assumption here. I'm going to assume that all of you have some belief about religion. I don't care what it is. No need to raise hands, right? You believe something. You believe in some particular religious truth. You're an atheist, you're an agnostic. Doesn't matter for my purposes. Regardless of what you believe, the vast majority of people who have ever lived have believed something different from you. Right? So the population of the Earth today is a tiny fraction of what appears to be the entire human population over the span of the existence of Homo sapiens as a species. No religious belief has anything like a majority position, with the possible exception of animism. Right? But animism, the belief that all of nature is ensouled, but animism comes in a gazillion different flavors. And by the way, I'm willing to use the unscientific a gazillion here. It's all right, a ton of different flavors. So. Animism comes in so many different flavors, no one of them turns out to be a majority position. Now, I'm guessing, correct me if I'm wrong, that you think your views about religion are correct. Because one of those, like, does anyone in here believe anything they think is false? Okay, good, yeah, that's good. Presumably, you think what you think about religion is true, and therefore you think that the vast majority of all people who've ever lived are wrong. You yourself already believe that most human beings think up wacky shit that they're wrong about. And of course, they're all happy to return the favor because they think the same thing about you, right? So you already believe that human beings make huge fundamental mistakes in their approaches to the world. And the Buddha says, is it really that much of a stretch from there to think that maybe they make a mistake about the conception of the self? Now, finally, and this is the, sort of the end of the Buddhist piece of this presentation, the Buddha says, about everything, but especially about the self, for goodness sakes, don't take my word for it. Go find out for yourself. Look for the self. Try to find it. Look in your experience and ask, is there something that has those right qualities of continuity, identity, and causality? And he says, if you find it, you're going to be the most famous philosopher in history. That's great. But if you don't find it, then maybe you'd be willing to ask again, is there really a self? And after that, enlightenment should be a piece of cake. So that's kind of the first step. All right, now, somehow I have to connect all this to politics. In 2007, the French publisher Édition La Fabrique, and by the way, if you thought my Pali pronunciation was bad, just wait till you hear my French, published a book titled L'Instruction qui vient, The Coming Insurrection. The book was written, as you can see, by the Invisible Committee, right? Obviously a pseudonym for folks who didn't want to put their real names on the book. The book argues that industrial society is in a state of collapse. It's very interesting. Again, I asked my class earlier this week what kind of story they thought they were living in historically, and in particular, whether they thought things were improving or declining, right? So what kind of narrative they thought they lived in. And actually, the majority answer was declining. I was very surprised. I thought people would say improving. But the majority of people in the room thought that the world was getting worse and was probably going to keep getting worse. It was very, very interesting. I was surprised by that. The Invisible Committee would be psyched. The Invisible Committee says, industrial society is collapsing. It's collapsing due to production problems. It's collapsing due to ecological damage. It's collapsing due to unequal distributions of income. And that's the best thing that could possibly happen, because then we can get rid of it. And replace it, they say, I'll cut to the punchline, right? They're anarchists, right? So we're going to replace it with a system in which production is carried out locally, so small-scale, voluntary production. Exchange is voluntary, right? So you exchange with other people to the extent you're interested in. And they say that kind of society, they hope anyway, would be freer. It'd be a society in which you as an individual were capable of kind of picking your own life a little bit more. Maybe the various different, they call them communes, right? The various different communes would have different kinds of life. And so you could be in a surfer commune if you were a surfer, or you could be in a, I don't know, a metalworking commune or an organic Brussels sprout growing commune or whatever it is that you like. And that you would be able to hopefully get the various things that you need because people who enjoy producing them or are willing to produce them would make them and then be happy to exchange them with you for whatever interesting thing it is that you produce. I'm not actually sure what it is that surfers produce, but it's something, right? Something worth exchanging. No offense against surfing, I'm just not sure what the exchange value is. So they think that the coming industrial collapse is the best thing that ever happened. Now the book, it became a cause célèbre, right? It became a kind of a public scandal because a group of 9 people from the tiny French town of Tarnac were arrested and charged with sabotaging some of the wires, the overhead wires on a French electric train system. Whereas, you know, France has an extensive public transit system. Many of the trains run on overhead wires, and someone threw a metal chain across 2 of the wires, creating a circuit, short-circuiting that portion of the train system and stranding tens of thousands of commuters. And no one actually knew who did it, but the police thought that it was these people who live in Tarnac on a little communal farm, and they arrested them. And part of their evidence was the claim that they had written this book. So the prosecutor said, we think you wrote this book because what you allegedly did really sounds like the kinds of acts of sabotage that this book suggests. And so they present this in court. And fairly quickly, this becomes kind of an intellectual scandal. And so a European and some American intellectuals sign this public letter denouncing the arrests and saying, look, these people are, A, we don't know whether they wrote the book at all, but B, even if they did write the book, they're being accused based on their ideas and not on their actions. Show us some evidence that they actually did it. Now, as it turns out, the authorities eventually dropped all the charges because they couldn't prove them. Right? So it turned out that they didn't have enough evidence to say that these particular people did it. No one was ultimately convicted. In 2009, this book was translated into English and published by the American publisher Semiotext with a strikingly similar cover. And that led to this.
Violence. Tonight, here is the one thing that everybody seems to be missing. The extreme left on this planet is actively calling for violence. As world economies go down the tank and unemployment continues to rise, which some might say, maybe some of these politicians actually want, the disenfranchised people are set to explode. And now, I was handed this morning when I got into work. I've been trying to get a copy of this for a while. It is a brand new book. It is a dangerous book. It is called The Coming Insurrection. The Coming Insurrection. It is written by the Invisible Committee. It calls for a violent revolution. An anonymous group from France, of all places, called the Invisible Committee, penned it. They want to bring down capitalism and the Western way of life. This started in France and started to spread to countries like Greece and Iceland, where people are out of work, out of money, and out of patience. Now, it's about to come here to America.
We'll pause there. It does go on. You can't make stuff like that up. So the thing that I love about this, so two things. One is that I knew this book was coming out. I was interested in reading it. I was sort of waiting for it to come out. And so I went to Amazon to see if it was in print yet. And in Amazon, when you pick the book, they say, people who searched for this book also purchased these other books. And the first book on that list was Glenn Beck's Common Sense. So people listen to Glenn Beck. The reason I mention this is that if Glenn Beck hadn't actually broadcast this last July or two Julys ago, the book probably would have been read by a few hundred people and then immediately forgotten. Right? Books like this are written all the time. Right? Some small group of people who have radical ideas, they write a book, again, a few hundred people read it. It's kind of got a little blip on the screen of folks who follow that kind of work, and then it disappears forever and no one pays any attention. But between the French prosecutors and Glenn Beck, it actually came to a little bit more prominence. I heard about it, I read it, and found it interesting. And the reason I'm telling you about it is that the book makes one really interesting argument. The book says, you're not a self, and the self is a handle by which the existing society manipulates and exploits you. So according to these guys, the self is a tool kind of imposed upon you, ultimately against your interest. Now, I should say, The Coming Insurrection is written in a very odd style. It's organized in chapters that are based on themes, so there isn't really an argument that runs through it. It's rather kind of meditations on a series of themes, and then you're supposed to kind of infer the broader argument from those themes. So it's going to be a little bit less clear than some of the stuff about the Buddhism. But here's what they say. They argue that capitalism's basic problem, at least in advanced industrial countries like the United States and Western Europe, is actually that it succeeds far too well. The basic problem with capitalism is that it produces way more than people really need very easily, and that a large portion of the population is basically unnecessary, right? That for many of the people, especially people who have relatively poor job skills, there really isn't that much for them to do. But the problem is, if you leave people unemployed, uneducated, and bored, bad things tend to happen. You may know the origin of the word sabotage, right? So French workers during the early period of the Industrial Revolution and before tended to wear, even before this, really, we're talking about sort of in the mill era, wore wooden shoes called sabots to work. And periodically, when they decided that they had been worked hard enough and they wanted a holiday, someone would toss one of their sabots into the delicate gears of the machine, thereby breaking it. And of course, the machine was broken, the repairman had to be brought in to fix it, and everyone had to go home. So sabotage is tossing your sabot into the machine so that you can go home. And the Coming Insurrection folks argue that capitalism suffers this kind of permanent danger of sabotage, that there's plenty of people who are basically superfluous, and it needs to somehow keep them busy. And what capitalism does to keep us busy, according to the Invisible Committee, is it encourages a high degree of narcissism, right? So it encourages us not only to develop a kind of obsession with ourselves and our interests, but also with our relationship to the economy. So for example, and no offense to the good folks at the Career Center, right? But the constant obsession with what's my resume look like? Have I done enough volunteer work in college? Have I polished my resume appropriately? Is my resume in the right typeface? Have I developed, and maybe some of you have done this, right? Do I have an appropriately sophisticated website instead of a resume so that I can demonstrate my technical savvy? That there's this sort of constant process of, I remember I used to have my nose pierced, and in grad school I said to a professor, so am I going to be able to get a job with a nose ring? And he said, yeah, as long as you take it out. And I said, yeah. But it's a sort of constant process of asking, like, am I the right person, right? Am I appropriately tooled and fitted to fit into the economy? And the Coming Instruction folks argue that that is one of the most obvious ways in which who you are, your personality, yourself, is ultimately a product of a society set up to make you a particular kind of person, a society that needs you to fit in a particular way, even if your particular contribution to the society will be living in your parents' basement and sending out lots of unresponded to resumes. And they say, and I'm going to quote from the text, they say, I am what I am, right? A famous line. My body belongs to me. I'm me, you're you, but something's wrong. Mass personalization, individualization of all conditions, life, work, and misery, diffuse schizophrenia, rampant depression, like I said, it's kind of poetic, atomization into fine paranoiac particles, hysterization of contact. These are their descriptions of modern life. And then they get to the point. The more I want to be me, the more I feel an emptiness. The more I express myself, the more I'm drained. The more I run after myself, the more tired I get. The harder I work to try to make a self, to be the self that I need to be to fit into modern society, the more exhausting I find the whole damn process. And they go on to say, it's not, the standard diagnosis of that is there's something wrong with you, right? That you're out of sync, you're out of step somehow, you're not the right kind of self, you're maladapted. And they say, well, that's not actually the right conclusion here. The problem is not that you have a defective self, the problem is that you think you have a self at all. And the self has been imposed upon you, they claim, from outside. So again, a quote. The self is not some thing within us that's in a state of crisis. It's the form they mean to stamp upon us. They want to make ourselves something sharply defined, separate, accessible in terms of qualities, controllable. And the Invisible Committee suggests if somehow you could kind of loosen your conception of self, if you could say, maybe it's not so urgent that I have a particular identity, that I fit in a particular way, then maybe you could see that the self is someone else's tool. And again, a quote. Everything that attaches me to the world, all the links that constitute me, all the forces that compose me, don't form an identity, a thing displayable on cue, but a singular shared living existence from which emerges at certain times and places that being which says I. So that, again, like the Buddhist conception, there is the actuality of your existence, and then there's this conception of self layered on top of it, right? There's this optional addition. And they say, I am what I am, this statement of identity, is not simply a lie, a simple advertising campaign, but a military campaign, a war cry directed against everything that exists between things, against everything that circulates indistinctly, everything that invisibly links them, everything that prevents complete desolation, against everything that makes us really exist. So the point of me telling you this is not particularly to try to convince you that the Invisible Committee has the right angle on contemporary capitalism, but rather to point out that the argument they make is strangely similar to Buddhism. Right? Some of the points of connection are probably already obvious, and I think there are four. First, that the self is an illusion. What we think is real isn't. That the self is a major cause of our problems. That it's possible to get rid of the self, and that you'd be better off if you did get rid of the self. Now, one piece I want to emphasize. You just don't hear this argument a whole lot from Western philosophy. There are certainly thinkers who've argued that there really is no self. David Hume is a well-known example. He says the self is ultimately an illusion. And then he says, but you can't live without it. There's certainly thinkers who've argued that the self is the source of most of our problems. Sigmund Freud is a sort of an obvious example, but there are plenty more. But you really don't see that many people in the Western tradition, and in fact, I can't off the top of my head think of any, who argue that you would be better off without a self, because you don't see that many people in the Western philosophical tradition who think you can get rid of the self. So this is a relatively unusual argument, and that's part of what made me interested and trying to figure out the connection. What is it that holds these two things together? Now, I want to point out that there are three interesting differences between them. Although the self is an illusion, notice that they disagree about where the self comes from. According to the Buddha, the self is generated by your personal mistakes. According to the Coming Insurrection, the self is generated by other people kind of against you. The second difference has to do with what effect getting rid of the notion of the self would have. The Coming Insurrection argues that, so let's take one step back. The Coming Insurrection argues that the self is the product of bad social conditions. The Buddha argues that the self is the cause of bad social conditions. And finally, the Buddha argues that you get rid of the self through introspection. The Coming Insurrection argues that you get rid of the self largely through destroying capitalism, right? Largely through large-scale social change. And so although they have, in some ways, the same diagnosis, they have very different solutions about what you should do, very different proposals about the conclusion. Part of my project is to try to understand in what way does seeing these two different perspectives on the same question help us? What does it teach us? And so now we come to the conclusion of my talk. And this is where I'm supposed to explain to you why you should care, who's right, and to give you some information about how you should change your life based on the wisdom that you've received. Let's start with why you should care, also known as so what. Why does it matter? And I want to suggest that I hope that the talk has at least convinced you to consider the following claims. First, I hope the Buddha's convinced you that there's at least some reason to wonder whether you are or have a self, whether there really is anything that has those essential qualities of identity, causality, and continuity. Second, I hope that the Buddha has convinced you that believing that you have a self may lead to problems, that it may be both harmful and self-defeating. Third, I hope that the Coming Instruction has convinced you that believing that you're a self can give other people a handle to manipulate you and perhaps even to exploit and oppress you. And finally, I hope that the differences between the Buddha and the Coming Insurrection have pointed out that even if you are now skeptical about the notion of a self, there isn't necessarily one simple answer to it, right? There isn't necessarily one path from thinking that maybe the self isn't all that it's cracked up to be to then figuring out what to do about it. This leads naturally to the question, why does any of this matter for politics? Right? I teach political science. In what way is this somehow connected to politics? And I want to suggest that there are three kinds of connections. The first is, if you believe that people have souls that are going to live on after the death of their body, you're going to have beliefs about what you want government to do. You may want government to help them do the appropriate care for their souls in appropriate ways. You may think that government should simply keep its paws off their souls altogether, right? That it's not government's job. Second, if you think that people have a fundamental nature, that may lead you to believe that certain kinds of politics are or are not possible. For example, if you think that people are naturally greedy and selfish, well, certain kinds of politics are obviously going to be foolish and self-defeating. Similarly, if you think people are naturally good and kind and altruistic, well, certain kinds of politics are going to be unnecessarily harsh and repressive. So what you believe about selves and about kind of how thick the self is turns out to matter to what you think is possible. Finally, the question of toleration. If you believe that people have fixed natures and essences, on the one hand, that may make you more tolerant. You may think they can't change. It's not their fault that they're the way they are. But on the other hand, you might think they can't change and I can't stand them. And since they can't change, we'll have to do something with them, right? We'll have to restrain them in some way. We'll have to make them stop bugging me since they can't do it on their own. Finally, the last and most important question, who's right? Is the Buddha right about the origin of the self? Is the coming instruction right about the origin of the self? Are they both wrong? And I'm going to give you the most annoying answer possible. I don't know.
Because I think there isn't really an abstract answer to this question. So I want to end this by talking about two different ways of approaching philosophy. Sometimes philosophy really acts like logical proof. Those of you who read Kant's Critique of Pure Reason have a little experience of this, right? You keep Kant, if you combine his premises, you're really on for the whole ride, right? Kant is so relentlessly clear, so relentlessly logical.
You start off with him, you get to the end, you think, yeah, well, that's just all obviously true. Right? It's got a kind of persuasive force of its own. But there are other kinds of philosophy that are a little bit closer, I think, to poetry. They paint a picture and say, is that the way the world looks to you? Does that sound about right? What do you think? And I think that both the Buddha and the coming insurrection are making those kinds of arguments. They're not proving something to you that is kind of logically airtight. They're saying, here's the way the world looks to us. If it looks that way to you too, let's keep talking. We've got some other stuff we'd like to tell you. But if the world doesn't look that way to you, probably there's not going to be any reason that you're going to want to go any further with them. I hope that you do, but I think that's where they end up. So with that, I end. Thank you very much for your kind attention and laughing in all the right places. And I turn things over now to our MC.